Chad, it's great to have you here. You are one of my favorite people in the entire world, not just in the state of Utah. I don't know that a lot of people know this, but there would be no Silicon Slope Summit without you and without your team at Cornerstone. And you're such a legend in this community, even beyond Summit and all of the events you've done for all of the top tech companies. I mean, you are the number one event production company in the state, no question. I don't think there's anybody even close. I don't even know who number two would be.
Well, that's pretty nice.
but I mean that. And I wonder, like, just so people can get to know, because you're always like backstage, right? You're kind of always behind the scenes. And I wanted people to get a sense for who you are, who Cornerstone is, what Cornerstone does. How did you get started in all of this?
Well, I started my career really within this community.
Yeah.
Like, that's what's always beautiful. And I felt like when you asked, and by the way, you are my favorite person. Like, really, there, you know, out of all the famous people I've met, you could walk in my office tomorrow and I have one picture that I display other than my lovely wife and children, and that's Clint Betts.
Is that true?
It's very true.
Oh my gosh.
But I will make it a point to send you that picture of the picture. But no, Clint, I started in this community and started with really the grassroots of what it was, and that was with Alan Ashton and Bruce Bastian at WordPerfect. Yeah, and obviously that wonderful group of humans is why I'm here today. You know, I mean, I really could name every single one, and you know, seeing the passing of Bruce here, you a month or so ago, like, you know, he was a very, very kind, very, very generous man. So was Alan. So the whole executive C-suite team was amazing humans, and they really instilled in me the hard work side, but more of the doing what's right always, you know, sort of mentality. And I think that's what we've carried over, because that was the greatest place I ever worked, you know.
Really?
Yeah. Hands down.
And was that in the Orem campus?
It was 1600 North campus. You know, when I was hired, I think I was right around 800, the 800th employee. So, you know, anybody that knows the history of that company knows that it grew to some pretty big numbers as far as a Utah based company. I want to say just north of 3,000 people.
That's an enormous company.
And it's heyday, but
and then it gets acquired, right?
I know Novell. I went through that.
Novell acquired it. And do they move to Provo at that point, or does it stay in Orem?
To be honest with you, Clint, there was a division of teams, so there was kind of a little bit of a both. I stayed in the Orem facility, in the WordPerfect campus facility.
I love
that
campus. I still love it.
It was like, you know, because I was still in college at the time, and it was like a big university. Everybody knew one another. Everybody loved one another. And you know, it was like, it really was. And, but yeah, I stayed there, mostly because of my role there and being involved with a lot of the, which was really kind of an interesting thing, because we did a lot of think tank, development on, you know, like voice recognition and distance learning. And so I was part of that group, and then we would actually translate. We were kind of a technology bridge from the marketing campaigns. Like, so we would listen to the marketing campaigns, and we would translate those campaigns into really productions. And I say technology because it really was the use of technology and really cutting edge technology to translate and communicate those stories. And I really think that path is what led Cornerstone to be very different in the space.
Yeah.
You know, meaning that Cornerstone's early years, we weren't focused like a traditional production company will sell you on the cameras and the lights and what we can do.
We bought all from you.
Well, thank you.
By the way,
you.
Cornerstone thank built you. Even this studio. The studio we sit in now.
It was a labor of love.
Where we are right now, like, you literally built this studio.
Well, thank you. We have so many talented people. I swear that's the best part of Cornerstone is just the team. But you know, I don't know. I mean, it's just a really, really cool path that we were flowing, you know, that we followed down, and that's really how we sold our services. Like it really wasn't. At the time, there wasn't a lot of people that thought that way.
Yeah.
You know, and agencies eventually, like, hey, you know, we're agencies. We should understand that. So there was a lot of live event agencies and we would support them. And then kind of on our path, we just eventually just became really an end-to-end solution.
Yeah.
You know, for our clients and companies seeing everything that they would possibly need, you know, in their efforts as far as marketing and sales and so on. So, it's been a lot of fun though.
I want to talk about what had you leave and why you left WordPerfect, but real quick, because, you know, Bruce has been on my mind lately, given, you know, he just recently passed away. And Alan as well, we gave him a Community Hero Award, again, an event that you produced for us.
I love that family.
And he was, I think we gave him a Lifetime Achievement Award. I think he's the only person in Silicon Subs' history who's gotten that award, actually. Yeah. There's been some Hall of Fame awards, but that one in particular. What did you learn from those two?
Oh, man. Let's start out of respect with Bruce. You know, I think Bruce was just such a compassionary soul. You know, I remember as a young kid, you know, he had such a love for the entertainment side. And, I remember setting in, and again, because we were a technical team, we were all over the map. You know, one day I would be doing this and the next I'd be doing that. But I felt like Bruce was just really a compassionate person. And he took extra effort to make sure that you knew how much he appreciated you and how much he loved you. And I got an opportunity. I hadn't saw Bruce in a number of years, and one of your Hall of Fame events, I actually, you know, went over to his table and I reminded him who I was. You know, a lot of people, I want to share a very, very candid point of view with Bruce, is I later found out I was actually related to Bruce. But I had worked with Bruce for many, many years before we ever both figured that out. But Bruce was really the compassion side of Bruce actually allowed me to get some really, really specialized advanced education. You know, he actually sent me to school with specialized schools.
Really?
Yeah, Hollywood Motion Picture Studios in Hollywood, California. Oh, wow. Went there when they started upping their game in the video production side and building out a lot of their studios that were much like this, and for a lot of their distance learning efforts and so on and so forth. And then he also had me study under a gentleman that was a world-renowned design engineer for audio recording facilities by the name of Chips Davis. And so I spent, you know, really on Bruce's dime, his personal dime, spent a large portion of my career, like really honing skills that today I still use and I cherish. And I was able to talk to him about that. But I'll never forget, you know, as a struggling student, you know, every penny counted in my world. I didn't come from I came from a very loving family, and I'll leave it at that. But I remember one time Bruce, after a performance, it was actually with the Osmonds, David, if you're out there. a lot of those kids grew up to be friends, but they were the next generation Osmonds, you know, and they were, I think at the time they were probably 8-10 years old, you know, and they performed, and Bruce had performed in conjunction with their father, Merrill. And he walked backstage and he, you know, pulled out $500 and he pulled me aside and told me how much he appreciated me. And at the time, that was a lot of money in my world and made a lot of things possible. And it just so happened it was during a Christmas benefit show for all the WordPerfect employees and their families and stuff. And it really meant the world to me. And I thought, you know what, like that's part of, it meant a lot. And I remember those moments in time of being just like really thinking the world of him.
Yeah, he's a very special man.
So Alan. Man, Alan, I can't say enough about Alan. You know, I mean, I was lucky that in a lot of ways I was, you know, relatively close to his sons that were roughly my age. And I was a little bit older, so I was kind of like the fun brother. They had provided me such a great opportunity that I remember I'd take them boating. You know, I had a boat. I was like 21 years old and I had my boat. And so I'd take them boating and we'd just have fun. It was almost like, you know, hanging out with, like being an older brother to him. And I didn't have brothers. So that was really neat. But then I got to work for Karen and Alan, both at WordPerfect and then a lot of their private events, you know, which one that I still hold dear. And that's the Timpanogos Storytelling Festival. That was the first event I ever sold, Clint.
Really?
I didn't even know I was a salesman. I really wasn't. because I literally called up Karen and I said, I'd love to do this for you, Karen. She's like, well, I would pay you. And I'm like, no, I don't need payment. I just want to do this for you because I love the family so much. But you know, you grow up and I've been lucky enough that some of the older children have married some business leaders in the community, and I've worked alongside of Paul Eddington, Alan's oh, yeah. brother-in-law or son-in-law, sorry, yeah. and Toby Norton, which is Alan's son-in-law yeah. as well, and they married some wonderful you know daughters of Alan and Karen, and so man, it just comes full circle every time I turn around. I run into leaders, you know, business, you know, venture capitalists that are now investing back in technology, and all of the roots lead back to really the WordPerfect.
This was dynasty. Very early days of Silicon yeah. Slopes.
Yeah,
you know, right there at the beginning of it, which is really cool. Tell me about Timpanogos storytelling. I mean, that thing still goes.
It is. Yeah.
How many years are we in for that?
Oh my gosh!
Like 30? Well,
probably 30, 31.
I was going to say.
Yeah. Yeah. Which I should know that. I probably should have did.
No.
I probably should have fact checked, yeah. but no, real news. Yeah. 30, 31 years old. I mean, Cornerstone's now coming into its 31st year. And when I say that was the first event that I really picked up the phone and asked to be involved with is, and you know, the Acersons, Jeff, and his family have really, really played an instrumental role in that. And his wife is Karen as well.
Yeah.
But they're obviously Jeff's a great guy. I think he's one of those too, you know, that I need to thank. And obviously Corrine Clark. Oh my gosh. I can't even begin to say enough about her. So,
Corrine was just sitting where you are.
Wow.
2 hours ago.
Nice.
She's
one of my favorite
beautiful
people.
Beautiful woman.
Yeah.
Just the kindest soul ever.
Yeah.
I was telling her, my son got diagnosed with cancer a year and a half ago, maybe 2 years now.
Yeah.
And I was like, you were my first call, Corrine. Like, she was literally my first call.
You know.
Like, what do I do here? And she said, I got it.
Man.
How crazy is that?
Well, you can't make me cry on this one, but I remember finding that out when they diagnosed Corrine, and it seems like, you know, there was kind of a group. There's a group of people in that what I would say that very close community, and I'll leave the others nameless. But you know, a few of them had fought that battle, but Corrine was the first one, and I remember her transformation as a person,
mm-hmm.
And her drive in beating it, and it was second to none. It I mean, she is a survivor because she never would take the diagnosis yeah. of being, you know, being ill, and I, that's what I admire about her. Like it, you know, I think you have daughters, right?
And I have one daughter.
Yeah, yeah. And you know, I've been blessed with two, and I think like you can't help but want to raise your daughters the way that Corrine is and who she is. You know, she stood in a lot of very, very small circles, and she has made a beautiful life for so many people. Yeah. And I would not be here without her love and her blessings in so many ways, honestly.
Yeah, she really is just the best.
Yeah.
It's interesting you brought her up because she really was just sitting there.
Wow.
And she said that she was the only survivor of her cohort during that.
Yeah.
She got a really serious, so it was ovarian cancer, yeah. which is, you know, doesn't have the best survival rates.
No.
And she comes out of that thing guns blazing. And whenever you see her, she's like, I'm alive.
Yep. Yep. And she lives, and she lives every single day like it.
Yeah.
That's what I love. It's not, you know, I think a lot of people would have, you know, professionally speaking, even during her journey, she was always present.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that, I mean, I've never had that conversation. I hate to speculate, but you know, like when they say it's almost a little bit of the mind over matter, I think she's a mind over matter person. I think she was, like I said, I think she was unwilling to accept the diagnosis. And that to me is like, you know, it gives me cold chills because I hope I'm that, You know, like I've walked down a yellow brick road my entire life. Like, and I mean that.
Yeah.
And, man, I would have to think there's gotta be something at the end of it that's going to, that's going to make me, you know, look at life differently. But she's one of my biggest heroes. And I think, you know, like when I heard, I was so sad.
Yeah.
You know, you think of the worst, you know, and especially like, I knew that it was a very aggressive form and I knew somewhat the statistics, you know, but to see what she's done it and the empowerment and, her outlook, like it's contagious. Right. Yeah. And I know that's why, you know, like I remember very, very well when that happened with your son, and that's crazy. And
tough,
and you need those people in your life.
She's just like, I got it.
Yeah.
And she did. It was crazy. Like he was in, he was up there in primary children's that afternoon. And we were like trying to figure out like, where do we go?
Where do we go? What do we do?
She's like, nope, I got it.
I got it.
You gotta be there at 3.
Yep. I'm like, what? Yeah. Yeah.
And he stayed there for a week.
Yeah.
Like we went up there and we were there for a week.
Yeah.
It was crazy.
Yeah.
It was wild.
Well, you know, like that's the thing. It's like, how do you ever repay someone like that?
Yeah.
You know, like I've thought like a million times over. I never asked for anything in return.
Yeah.
I think like Corrine, if you're going to watch this, I hope you do. I think the only thing I've ever been able to do for her, she called one time. She's like, I need 21 pilot's tickets, Chad. I'm like, done. that's the return. Man, I could live with that. Cause I mean, I owe everything to her, you know?
So. Yeah. What had you leave WordPerfect? Was it Corrine?
Like,
cause she was over there too. Wasn't she?
Well, yeah. Like this is really interesting. So the acquisition of, you know, when Novell acquired WordPerfect, about 6 months in that acquisition, they came to us and we were, you know, we were one of those groups that didn't make any sense for Novell to have a group like ours. Mm-hmm. And I think I was very real about that, you know, even at 22 years old, I mean, I could see that. And, and so they had approached me and my, current partner at Cornerstone and challenged us to write a business plan and, save our whole team, which is over 20 people. Okay. And, you know, you're talking to two engineers, like really two engineers.
Yeah.
You know, so we spent the next probably week and a half down at the BYU library trying to figure out how to write a business plan.
Yeah, like what is a business plan?
And back then,
that
was a lot harder than today. Let's put it that way. Presented that, to a woman, Barbara Lyons. I don't know if anybody will even know that name, but I remember it very distinctly because, you know, in as much as that's when I felt like that was the one woman that handed me my, you know, my marching orders and laid off our whole group. Cause that's really what happened. We presented the whole business plan and within a month they all brought us in as a big 20 person group and systematically fired us all in one fatal swoop. And I was young, you know, Clint, like I'm sitting around a table with guys that were probably my age, you know, and, they were looking for that to be their last job, not another job, you know, and it was really sad, but I was kind of this weirdly, you know, probably a weirdly excited and, you know, I really was excited, I guess. Like, I don't even know how to describe it because I was like, guys, now we can go on and do what we really want to do. You know, I was like, kind of like awkwardly, and I was young. You know, I mean, I was young. I had two kids and a mortgage. That wasn't so, you know, but I didn't think about that until, you know, 48 hours later. But I was excited, and I kept on telling everybody, I'm like, you know, we're going to go on and we're going to find our greatness, you know, and we're going to do stuff that we couldn't do here, you know, because, like, you know.
Yeah.
You know, many big companies are. I'm not saying all, but sometimes it's like, sometimes I always felt like we knew what we needed to do and we could advance certain things.
Mm-hmm.
Anyway. But they laid us off and 3 days later, like this was on a Thursday. So come Monday, actually on a Sunday, I get just a random phone call. And a gentleman introduced himself as, his name was Tom Ryder. And, he introduced himself as like, you know, I'm interested. I represent, Bush Creative. which a lot of you may know them. I mean, they are the creative arm of Anheuser-Busch. And at the time, they were doing a lot of really, really cool projects, both theme park and then communications-wise, and looking to grow it. They eventually
I didn't realize they were going to do theme parks.
Yeah, they actually own SeaWorld and Busch Gardens.
Oh, I thought they were going to do like literally a Budweiser theme park.
Yeah.
Where like you go in there and you just drink and ride rides.
I would hope that never
happens. Wouldn't that be crazy? That's when you said that, I was like, oh my
this
gosh.
This is the greatest immersive experience ever.
Budweiser has a theme park where you just go and drink and ride and rides. That sounds incredible.
Yeah exactly. Sign me up. But no, that, you know, and he said, I want to talk to you on Monday. You know, I just landed here in Salt Lake City, he said. And I was like, okay. And had no idea. Well, literally that day we sealed the deal where I came back doing the exact same thing, same desk that I just cleaned out. And really it was very good monetarily speaking, you know, it was really good, which is important because that was really what gave us the original seed money to go and then do Cornerstone. And so it was about 8-9 months into that. And Tom said, you know what, it looks like that we're probably going to do away with this operation. But all the good news is all of you guys have jobs, but you're going to have to relocate to St. Louis. Mm. And I when I first heard that, I really had no interest. You know, at this point in my life, I'd traveled a lot, domestically, internationals, like supporting it. I loved that. But I could never, ever see myself living outside of Utah per se, just because, you know, just because I had a small family and things like the things that we all value about Utah. Right.
Yeah.
And so I was like, I don't think I really want to do that. So what's the next journey? And that really took me to where I actually, for a time I worked for a company called the US Satellite, and they were owned by, the America Stores, which was, the Skaggs family.
Oh, yeah.
And I did a lot of design work. Which is really weird because I designed everything from prison security systems, like level 4 security.
That's
for
cool.
Prisons all the way to like data transmission and even like global positioning, for large, shipping companies and things. Like it was like a smorgasbord of anything that you know, and what was funny is like, again, you fall back on the wonderful people that had given me so many opportunities. And I went there. And I walked in the first day, and it was the general manager was conducting a meeting with you know, probably all the salespeople, as I would remember. It was probably all the salespeople within the organization. There were about 30 people in the room, and then probably all the executives within that. And I know LS was in there at the time, and they introduced me, you know, to the boardroom. And I told a little bit about myself, and they got this big, this will sound crazy, Clint, but it's true, hand to God. Mm-hmm. But there's this big equation on the board, and they are building this giant tracking system, a global tracking system, for a very major freight company, really? Similar to like a FedEx.
But
what they wanted to do is real time updates on where these trucks were for like basically building out almost like at Novell I designed one they called the NOC, and it monitored networks around the world and would show you like a dashboard of up to date, you know, like networks they were administering, like giant networks, financial networks and so on and so forth. So I built these before. So I walk in and there's this big equation on the board, and there's all these model numbers and everything. And they're like, hey, you know, here's the new guy. And he has extensive, you know, background in this and that. And so I told them a little bit about myself, and they look up there on the board and they're like, well, what would you do? And, you know, like a lot of these guys, respectfully, they were like brilliant minds when it came to like data, like satellite, microwave transmission, you know, 800 megahertz radio transmission and in-car video, you know, for police officers stuff. But anyway, I'm like, I'm coming at it from a whole different angle. And they're like, well, what would you do? And I just like literally started rattling off, not just how I would do it, but actual physical model number, you know, make and model numbers. And I didn't think anything about it. And And this will sound like I'm boasting, and I'm not, because it was kind of sad. And I left the room, and I remember, like, in the aftermath, I'm like 30 feet away, and I hear the room just erupt into laughter. And I'm like, I remember thinking, like, oh my God, they think I'm crazy. They truly think I'm crazy. And that was my last project. I was there for about a year, but I saw that, literally designed that whole project. I freelanced to finish it off because we'd already started Cornerstone, but I saw it through, and it was a wildly successful program. I was able, as a consultant at that point, train other people how to run it and how to build them. And it became, like, for a while, it was one of their business units that they focused on, about going around the globe and providing those big control centers like that.
But it was
funny, because my boss, my former boss, he's still a good friend of mine. He actually left the company, and ironically, he was a fire chief for the airport authority, and then just retired here like about a week ago. But we always stayed in touch, and he's like, when you left the room, I thought you were crazy. And, like, because, you know, everybody had been scratching their head trying to figure it out. And he's like, you just walk in there, and you're just like, yeah. And it's like this and this and this.
You just Goodwill Hunting.
Yeah, it was. In fact, that's what I was awesome. Going to say, because I'm like, do not laugh, because I don't want you saying it. It's like a scene out of Goodwill Hunting, because it wasn't like that. It was more or less just like, it was really simple. But at the time, it was really complex technology.
Oh, for sure.
You know, because nobody had interfaced computers and displayed computers. Yeah. And, you know, Alan and Bruce had given me the opportunity to do that and then some, you know, it reminds me a lot of the book. You know, I'm a huge Malcolm Gladwell fan, and it reminds me of the book Outliers, you know, because it's like, it simply comes down to, it's not Goodwill Hunting. It's being in the right place at the right time with really wonderful people that believe in you and give you opportunities. And I think that's what Corrine would say in our private conversations. Just, she's like, I didn't do anything for you. All I did is provide an opportunity. But to kind of tie a bow around this, when we were getting ready to be moved back and to St. Louis, and I was kind of working at US Satellite and helping, you know, them at the WordPerfect facility, knowing the contract was up. And my current business partner and I were sitting in one of the studios one day, much like this. And we devised this plan of taking our business model that we had built, and we're like, let's take it up to Corrine and let's talk to her about not working internally here, but working as a contractor. And it was really awesome, because we walk into her office, you know, schedule a time. She was kind enough. Like, now I know what it really is like to be an executive at some level. Like, she was so busy. She shouldn't have taken that meeting, but she did. And she probably cleared her calendar, but that just is who she is, right?
Oh, yeah.
And we walk in the door, and literally probably 10 minutes into the presentation, it was either really bad, and she was like, just I would want to put an end to this, or I believe in these guys. And I would like to think it was that she believed in us. But she was just like, of course, why wouldn't I do this? And really, that was a business proposal to be a outside vendor, to support them in their efforts to use and leverage the equipment that they had made major purchases of, and continue to do exactly what we had done and take those marketing plans and those field marketing plans and make them come alive, in the trade show world and the corporate event space and everything. And so that really is, in a nutshell, a very long-winded nutshell about what we did. But
that's incredible.
Yeah.
What was your first, like, hey, we've really landed on something at Cornerstone? Like, what was the first, like, event or big client outside of, like, your network where you're like, well, this is cool?
Well, I think, you know, we picked up, I wouldn't say it was Novell, although I would definitely give them thanks, because that, you know, Corrine believing us and Novell being really a flagship, that was certainly just, it certainly allowed us to pay the bills, if you will, you know, like, 'cause we formulated a little teeny shop. But I think the real big one, was iOmega.
One that gets forgotten,
really forgotten, right? But iOmega at the time, that was quite a ride, because they were small. I remember going up to their facility in Roy and walking into one building that literally, you know, housed all of iOmega. And within 4 years, they were in 10 different buildings. And you know, again, like they, we all know the growth.
Yeah.
I don't think I need to go into that, but that was the first one. And by year five, you know, they had hired some big New York agencies, you know, what was it? Macy Noise, I think, was one of the big ones. Wow. They were doing these really big campaigns, and they literally took us around the world with them. And I mean, these were for a trade show. I mean, they were really more like a touring rock and roll show at some level. I mean, they were selling software, but in a very cool way. And we were happy to make that, you know, that kind of that leap or at least rise to the call. And I just remembered, you know, walking around again, like I wasn't a salesman. But you know, when it's on you, like your success or failure, man, I became a salesman really, really quickly. Yeah. And not a good one still. But
that's not true.
But you know, I remember walking around the shows and it was easy to add 10 clients per show. And I'm not talking like, I'm talking NEC, you know, I'm talking, even in our industry, adding major, you know, hardware manufacturers.
Yeah.
And, man, I mean, I think by year three, we were growing about 300-400% per year. That's, you know, it was, I mean, it was just straight up. And we would, you know, it was not uncommon to land like 8 or 9 different clients by simply just being like, they would just come around and look at what you were doing and then be like, are you in charge of this? You know, cause you, yeah, we're technicians. We're there before any of the salespeople, and they could see us installing it and stuff and always flying, you know, the WordPerfect, you know, yeah, corporate stuff. And then our own little branded identity that we had and our, you know, but it was very easy to get business cards. And then I would do follow-ups and, man, we landed some really amazing people in that.
That's incredible.
You know, clients and that have become lifelong friends. Like, that's a beautiful thing. I think, like, you know, we value relationships so much that it's really been really nice and easier to grow because, you know, like people have been kind enough to take us along on the journey. You know?
Yeah, so that's the beauty of it all right there. It's interesting because, you know, I would say right before COVID, we may have been at an event peak. You tell me.
Yeah.
But just like in general, it seemed like events were the number one way to sell products, community build, all that type of stuff. Yeah. COVID hits, we can't do that anymore.
Yeah.
Right? You kind of, now we have to do virtual. And what was that, like, as soon as COVID hit, what was Cornerstone? Like, what were you thinking at that point? Because, like, your whole business is in-person events.
Yeah. Well, you know, almost overnight, I was on the road when COVID really became a reality, and I was in Florida, and I remember getting a call from a very, very large, well, two very large clients back to back, one of which was Adobe, and just saying, you know, that these events are not going to happen in a traditional way. You know, you fall back on what you know. And what we did know is there were really two big transitions in Cornerstone. We really defined who we were in basically the trade show space.
Yeah.
But when 9/11 happened, a lot of momentum went into more of what I would say would be, you know, corporate events, you know, corporate sponsored events where they have a very definitive audience, you know. I mean, it's your community, right? Very produced partner pavilions rather than trade show experiences. Yeah. And that was the first transition in the industry. The second was really COVID. And the COVID experience to me was falling back on what had brought us to doing live events in the first place. Before we ever did a live event, we did studio broadcasts.
Mm-hmm.
A lot of these were being streamed, even back in 2002. And I was talking to a friend, you know, the Olympic announcement, how exciting is that?
Yeah.
But 2002 games in Atlanta, Georgia, we were actually streaming via a large fiber backbone from WordPerfect.
Really?
Oh, yeah, all the way to Atlanta for some major vans like Panasonic and stuff. So we would do data transmission for them. And because we had the pipes to do it, you know, yeah. and so if you back up, we fell back on our knowledge of producing basically studio like yeah. events. And then it's not a stretch for us. So overnight, when these two dominoes fall, we build out 11 studios in our space. You know, I mean, if you've ever been to Cornerstone, it is the mothership of all motherships. Yeah, it looks like
enormous.
Yeah, it looks like two Home Depots, yeah. you know, decided to combine. and overnight, we transformed that space into 11 fully functioning studios, one of which was, one was a whole virtual reality stage. We invested heavily into, augmented reality components to do those things. And I know you know this story because a lot of the technologies in yeah. here was really what we invested in. But really what we fell back on was our expertise in that world. It took me right back literally to 1991. and it was familiar. It yeah. was scary, but it was familiar. And seeing our industry, it was so sad because, you know, statistically speaking, 97% of our industry was displaced mm-hmm. overnight.
Yeah.
A lot of my friends were offloading equipment, had no jobs, were looking to take a job almost anywhere that we really weren't found. It was really, really sad, but we were able to. I mean, we took a hit momentarily because not everybody is necessary. And mm-hmm. we knew that there were tough times that were upon us, and we didn't know how. I mean, nobody knew how long. Like, there's a lot of yeah. a lot of factors oh, yeah. that made it pretty sure. pretty ominous. But we scaled, and we have like 8 different divisions in Cornerstone. A lot of them, you know, like our trucking and transportation went off and did their own thing. You know, they literally were hauling produce. Nothing glamorous.
Are
IFA.
You serious?
Oh yeah. And I love each and every one of those leaders and those directors because they found a way. I told them, I said, I will support you guys, but you figure it out too. Like, you know, yeah. and I will support you. And they did. And I was so proud of them because as we're writing and producing these virtual events and taking clients that are like, how, Chad, like, how do we do this? Mm-hmm. We've never done this. I'm like, I know how. And so writing, producing, and directing these all wall teams like Matt, yeah. Endicott, and the very oh, yeah. teams that have built yeah. this out, like we're building the functioning parts of it and not just studios, but each one of those studios had purpose. So we could actually build groups, and we had groups that were coming from LA, and we practiced very safe standards that were all adopted by everybody, mm-hmm. you know, and we weren't reckless, but people from Boston were coming here, LA. I mean, I can't even tell you the amount of people from Los Angeles were coming and using our facilities, and then our trusted and loyal, you know, yeah. clients and partners. And, you know, I had sold another software company. We took a lot of my personal money. I built our own streaming platform because I wasn't real oh, happy.
Yeah. Yeah,
yeah. Yeah. And that, you know, like when you talk about, I had a lunch the other day, with a client, and we had just kind of went down memory lane, but it was with Health Catalyst, and I know the Burtons.
Dan Burton.
Yeah, Dan was I think in here a while back, but
yeah, I love that man.
Yeah, I really, really do love that company. And at the time, like they have some amazing programmers, and we co-wrote a lot of the platform. We did something that had never been done, truly, and it won a bunch of awards. But the beautiful thing was Paul Horsmeyer with you know, partner within Health Catalyst. When we were all done, he granted us, he's like, that was as much intellectual property and your involvement was so needed that we want to, you know, give this to you. And those are the type of clients we have. And I can't say enough about those type of people.
Yeah.
You know, and everybody contributed, you know, like Stuart Gold, yeah. contributed to that platform, and his brilliant mind as far as field marketing and taking people around the world. We literally took people around the world. We took them to London. We took them to Singapore and Malaysia and in a virtual way. And it was very, very powerful. I'm still so proud of that. No, I don't think anybody's done anything remotely close to it, but that's the power, you know. But it comes from a team that, you know, we were talking about Corrine and the unwillingness to just be given the you know, a diagnosis. And I think that's what the team was.
Yeah.
They just all came together and we had a focus without even having to sit down and talk about the focus, because we didn't have even time to do that. We had time to act.
Yeah, you just had to go.
Yeah.
Isn't it interesting, like, when COVID hits, when we most need to be together, you couldn't.
Yep.
And so something like virtual events became, I mean, Silicon Slopes was doing them every day.
Absolutely.
Like, we became like almost like a local PBS station where we'd bring on the senators and governors and be like, hey, what's going on today? And they break news in there. And it was like weird.
Yeah. We did that same thing on the hardware side, like taking CARES Act dollars and helping, you know, Salt Lake County with building studios to then communicate. And like, I was really proud of even a lot of the, you know, making sure that all the Downtown Alliance people, like we had the broadcast planned. Like we like, you know, and that is proud. Like when you become a partner at that level and you're providing solutions at that level.
Yeah. That's so cool.
So
it's
powerful.
So cool.
Yeah.
By the way, you mentioned Stuart Gold, who's also a legend, and Silicon Slope Summit wouldn't be what it is without him, particularly those first like 3 or 4 years. I had no idea what I was doing. Nah, and he would just like scream at me until I figured it out.
He's amazing.
He's the best guy ever. I love him.
You know, I really can't say enough about him. Like he is one of those driving forces that just makes you better.
Oh yeah.
Whether you think you need to be better, he makes you better. And I tell him that all the time. Like, you know, it's just like, thank you for everything you've done for me. Probably one of the most loyal people I've ever met. Honestly.
Yeah, he's a great
guy. If he believes in you, it's earned.
Oh yeah.
You don't get a free pass. But he's a amazing
guy. Everybody loved him too. Like Walter, before he passed away, we'd go have dinner up at Walter's, me and Stu, and Walter would when he knew Stu was coming, would make sure like his picture with Stu was hanging up. It's just like, that guy is an incredible presence.
Yep.
What about like, so post COVID, have virtual events died down, only increased, hybrid? What is all this?
Hybrid for sure. We're still doing a lot of hybrid stuff, and the platform is more, you know, relevant than ever. Mm-hmm. We're still using our platform, reinvesting in certain areas that are streamlining. I always have had this passion for software development. So I'm still currently like kind of private and personal projects. I'm still doing some stuff that I'm super, super excited about. But yeah, most of them are hybrid and they use all the necessary ingredients, you know, like, so I think that's always going to be the case. Mm-hmm. You know, like I see it as enriching those international audiences. You know, there's definitely always, you know, I'll probably sound a little bit old school here. Because I, you know, in my lifetime and some of the speaking engagements that I've been involved with, there was always like when virtual gets to the point where it's really tested and true, then there will never be a need for an in-person event again. And I still, maybe I am old, but I challenge that. We love to be together. I think that's what was the saddest part about being isolated, is that we long to do business that way, face to face.
Oh yeah.
Because that's when it truly matters.
Yeah.
You know, it does. Like having those interactions with people, you know, technology will always certainly play its role, but having meaningful engagement and experience with one another is important. So I think the evolution of events is, it will be more of that. You know, the drive is certainly, you know, I get a chuckle because all these buzzwords, they never existed. I'm that old, you know, and I'm like, you know, when I hear stream, you know, and it just even, you know, virtual, it's like we were streaming, like some of the technologies that came out of Novell and stuff. I mean, we were streaming when there was not even a word for that, you know, like, you know, and that's what's kind of fun. But I think events, you know, I definitely continue to see the change. I think that's what's exciting.
Yeah.
Because every day is just exciting. It's like a whole new frontier.
The event space is such a big market.
It is.
And there's so many different ways you can tackle the issue. Yeah. Again, like you could be an all virtual event type of a company. Yeah. And virtual events are really interesting because you can get a lot more people, obviously, to log in.
Yeah.
But again, like you don't get that connection.
Yeah.
That in-person connection.
I feel like you got to treat them very distinctly different, you know, like, and high hybrid events really you know, those are televised events. Mm-hmm. You know, we're all right in the middle of the Olympic Games, right? And there's power in a televised event, certainly. But it's like, don't forget how fun it is to sit in that bleacher, yeah. See it firsthand. And I think that's it. You know, it's just your approach, yeah. You know, but we certainly, you know, we certainly find ourselves being very diversified in the industry. You know, we've got clients everywhere. And I should bring that up before we move off of that, because, you know, entertainment, you know, I really owe a lot of the quick recovery. The beautiful thing about our quick recovery was we were still doing virtual events, mm-hmm. but Ryan Smith and Smith Entertainment was very instrumental in keeping a lot of the sporting activities going and the mm-hmm. entertainment. And he has been so kind, him and Mark Powell have been so kind to let us help and assist in basically advancing from a labor perspective and a production perspective, all of the events that come through the Delta Center. Yeah. And that's been huge, and continues to be huge. And so that allowed us to go, you know, we had crews, we were able to keep people employed when there was very little going on in the corporate space. That entertainment space, as you know, was the first to recover, really.
Yeah.
And we had the people, we were helping and assisting in that. And that kept our teams employed and, you know, kept our doors open. And so those
something
two,
like an NBA game, like mm-hmm. it became even more important how it was produced, yeah. Right?
Right.
Just that right. Part's pretty interesting. Like, how are we going to engage fans who can't be in the arena?
That's the exciting part.
Yeah.
It really is. I mean, I think those things are the future, you know, because you said that. I mean, that, you know, the way that we were doing events and the way that we were marketing, that the bar was so high. Look at Domo and Josh and the bar that he set with Domo Palooza. Unprecedented.
I know.
You know, true Josh style, it's right? Crazy. Like, like a lot of respect. But, you know, I mean, that what was that? Was that a concert? Was that a business meeting? What was it? And that was the beauty of it, you know, but that sort of stuff, like that was a bar. That was a bar. And so, I mean, at some level, you know, like COVID forced us to do what is the next bar.
Yeah.
And I certainly have my ideas, mm-hmm. you know, I certainly have my ideas. I have my wishes,
yeah,
you know, of what that is, but to see Ryan, you know, I got the opportunity, obviously, thank you for letting us help you last year at Slopes, you know, in Silicon Slope Summer.
We're nothing without you.
Well, but you know, to hear Ryan really share his vision, and it had been shared before and in bite-sized pieces, but to see him take the stage and to see him paint the vision, mm-hmm. How inspiring. Like I'm sad that I'm growing old. I honestly, like, I feel like, you know, 15, I probably have maybe 15 years in me, and I'm certainly excited, but man, what a cool time.
Yeah.
What a cool time in this community. We were talking a little bit about CEO.com before we walked in here, but you look at Silicon Slopes and you look at all the things that are going on. You look at the business leaders that are not just taking these companies public, not just selling their interests, but their ability to keep, you know, their seat at the board.
Yeah.
But also take and reinvest, because, like, man, what a powerful vision. I think we all aspire to do that.
It's wild. Yeah. You know? I mean, where else would you reinvest in that community? Like, when you normally, like, when you see success, and I'm sure this has happened in Utah too, you kind of just bounce to Hawaii or,
Well, yeah, like a lot of people,
La Jolla, like who knows?
A lot of people, I mean, there's no worries. There's no, yeah. I mean, there is, right? I mean, we know, but you know, you wouldn't think of a man rolling up his sleeves and going back to work, maybe more passionately than before.
Oh, his legacy, you know? Ryan's legacy. Like, first, Ryan's the president of Utah now.
Yeah.
Right?
Like, oh, yeah. and what a beautiful torch passing.
Yeah.
Because like when you talk about the passing of the torch and to see the Miller family and everything that Gail and Larry have done, and then to steward that and pay that forward to a guy like Ryan, like, I mean, man, like that's our, I get teary eyed because, like, dude, that's a passing of legacy to legacy and knowing that it would, would be taken and build upon. And that's beautiful.
Oh, yeah.
That's beautiful.
Right when, I think it was when the deal closed or right close to it, we did a summit and he came out with Dwayne Wade. It was the one where Dwayne Wade came.
Yeah.
And he was like, you can't change New York, but we're going to change Utah.
Utah.
Like, we can build here. Like, it's new frontier.
Yep.
And he's coming through in ways that I don't think, like, he's got an NHL team.
Oh my gosh.
Real Salt Lake.
Yep.
Like, he's like, it's beyond everybody's
acquisition of the South Town.
Yeah.
Yeah. Like that's what I'm saying. What a wonderful steward of that, you know, like, and man, we'll all benefit from that. Our kids as kids will benefit from that. They'll be entertained. They'll be employed. They'll, you know, like hands down. Like, I mean, I know that we were a great option for the Olympics, but come on.
Yeah.
By the time they get here, do you know what Smith Entertainment will have, have built and accomplished the facilities and the ability to get to those facilities like effectively? And like, man, it's what an exciting time.
Yeah.
I was up last week, you know, sitting down with the Jazz organization, and you know, man, what an amazing, I mean, not only is he a great guy, but he put great teams together.
Yeah.
You know, people that not only listen to the passion, but move the needle.
Yeah.
And that's what's exciting to me. And, you know, it's just a really exciting time. And I'm excited to be more and more involved with that. Like, we're working on some stuff that, especially for the NHL stuff, and not going to ruin anything. But man, I mean, keep your eye on that ball. Like, cause it's going to be fun.
Yeah. That opening game for the NHL team, it's going to be nuts. That's going
to
be historic.
To see Utah show up.
Yeah.
You know, that's what makes me proud, is because, you know, we see NBA All-Star game come here and people showed up like never before. We see UFC. You know, look at that brand. I mean, is this really a fight market now? It's always been resigned to you know, the Jersey Shore and Vegas. Yeah. And, you know, and I look at that and I think, like, you know, there's statistics that the reason why they're here, and that's because people show up and they spend and they support, you know, like, maybe spend's the wrong word, but they support and like no other. I mean, to take one of the smaller mid-sized markets and to think of what they're doing to support that.
Particularly and, UFC, it's really interesting.
Oh, yeah.
I mean, Vegas is an hour away.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
exactly.
Like the prime market, and to still choose Salt Lake City is fascinating.
Yep. Will we be shocked? Will we be shocked when we have the Major League Baseball here? Will we be shocked when we have an NF team here? I doubt it. I won't be. You know, I mean, well, that's
we'll
where
have
we're
a
headed.
Major League Baseball team, I think, before the Olympics.
I do too.
I think
I do
we'll
too. That's so exciting.
Which is so cool. That's
the community.
That's the mecca right there. There's nothing like a ball game.
Right.
Like just sitting in the stands in a ball game. It's
incredible. Especially as an outlet here, as an alternative outlet here for those summer months.
Yeah. And we're a baseball state. Dude.
Yeah.
It's a very baseball heavy state.
Yeah.
Finally, what are some of your favorite events, favorite speakers, favorite, you know, musicians or bands that you've produced? Because you've done thousands and thousands, and you have done it for the biggest names in music, the biggest speakers in the world.
Yeah.
You mentioned Malcolm Gladwell. I bet you've produced him a million times. Like who are some of the ones that stand out?
Wow. I think people stand out, you know, to me. You know, I mean, I was almost giddy when I met Malcolm. Just because I'd read all of his books. I was kind of like, he probably was a little creeped out. You know, I remember when he showed up in the car, and I'm normally not that way. And I just admire, you know, like, didn't get weird or get up in his space, but just admire him because he's just brilliant, you know, and I've always looked up to him. He was definitely one. You know, as far as entertainment, man, it's so hard because, like, I think what gets me really excited and you know, first of all, you came down. I'm in a small little joint venture on a music festival. Well, Clint Betts, who shows up? Clint Betts. Thank you.
The coolest music festival, by the way, Fort Desolation. Everyone needs to check it out. Like, that thing is going to be huge.
Man,
you're just getting started there.
You know, a lot of them are emerging artists, and I really love that. I mean, I love every kind of music, but man, I mean, a lot of those emerging artists, because you build friendships with them.
Oh yeah.
You know, like I'm super fond of this woman from Nashville, Olivia Wolf. If you don't know her, look her up. We brought her out to Fort Desolation. I hired her for a private party of another company I'm an investor in. That was when I first met her. And then I just got her a gig at the Summit Music Festival in Park City, just here, like in a couple of weeks. Like, but go if you're up that way, you're looking for a cool, it's cool event. But yeah, she's great. But she's a great human.
Yeah,
you know. And I'm like, you know, I think that would what would make me sad, Olivia. You can't fail because I would shed a tear because you're so cool. But I honestly believe that those are the sort of people. Like, I really love a lot of those emerging acts. But you know, like, I have been very lucky to work with a lot of different artists, but really some of the fledgling ones are the ones that get me the most excited. Yeah. But
you had Paul Coffin at Fort Desolation. Yeah. I love Paul Coffin. I'm like obsessed with Paul Coffin. Like I've never seen anybody own a stage like Paul Coffin does. And he's just an incredible musician, everything.
Yeah.
And that's somebody who, like, I imagine 3-4 years from now will be a huge, huge name. And Sierra will be huge if she's not already huge.
Like, yeah.
I mean, yeah, everybody needs to check out Fort Desolation down there in
Torrey.
I was going to say
Torrey, Utah.
But it's so beautiful.
Yeah, beautiful. Like, yeah, like, this isn't a plug, but it's the place that the facility is Cougar Ridge. And if you've never been there, you owe it to yourself. It is the Amangadi of Torrey, Utah, truly.
Oh, yeah.
Beautiful facility that a very, very kind and generous man built, took his life's passion and translated into building out something very, very special. And he's a great, great guy. But it's really cool vibe. And it's like, it's kind of still in its infancy.
We're going to blow that thing up.
Yeah. Man. Like, it's just, it's really, really cool. And I'm happy to be a part of that. We'll have to put something together and, you know, do something when it gets closer next year. But yeah, it's just that's really fun. I like that vibe. I like those emerging artists. Then, you know, speakers and stuff, like, man, like Summit event, like how, like, I don't know if you knew this or remember this, but, you know, I've been lucky enough in my career. I put Tony Robbins on stage a couple of times.
Yeah, you've done Tony a few times.
But yeah, like, shall we not forget? Tony came off the stage this year. He went out in the audience. Whose head did he rub?
Yeah, it's your head. How cool is that? I was freaking out when he was doing that line. I was like, that's Chad.
Yeah. Roxanne with the Utah Warriors. I think you've met her. Like, she shows up the next day with a Tony Robbins rub my head t-shirt that she custom built. So thanks, Roxanne. But no, I think that's, you know, just man, you guys put such a, I mean, I that is really the beautiful part of Silicon Slopes, is the inspiration as a business, as an entrepreneur, and as a businessman. Like, man, it's so inspiring.
Well, we've been lucky to get some really great people to come out to Utah. And I don't know if I have the confidence to invite Tony or Zuckerberg or Tim Cook if I didn't know you were producing the show. And I mean that entirely.
Really?
Like, I'm like, I don't know. Like, I know when Zuck comes,
which
is probably our pinnacle event. I think there's about 30,000 people there. And again, this is like 3 months before COVID. And I think Summit's probably a 50 to 75,000 person event if COVID doesn't hit.
Yeah.
Like, it was on an insane trajectory. And it still is a great event, and it'll get there. But, yeah, I don't have the confidence to invite him if I don't know and the produce, like, I mean, you produced that and he streamed it on his personal Facebook page to millions and millions of people. And I'm like,
I remember
of course
that
I can do that.
Number. Yeah. Yeah. Well, you know, like, yeah. When you take the names out of it, it's the same stuff, you know, like that. That's why sometimes, you know, it's like it, you know, out of all the people that I put on stage, I have one guitar.
Oh, who is it?
You'll laugh, but it's you'll laugh because it's a band by the name of Tool. And
awesome.
The reason I love it is because all of his music is written and it's arranged classically. So I've actually, like, part of Cornerstone's events, like, I've deconstructed it and had a quintet play many numbers. And it's funny because, like, I mean, I just think he's a beautiful writer and very deep, like, you know, like
for sure.
And musician wise, they're very talented, collectively. And I know that a lot of people are like, what? But yeah, I really do. I really, really like, you know, I just, as an artist, it's like, I think as an artist, he's not mainstream like some of the bigger ones, but it's by design. He's very passionate about his music and he's just an amazing writer and an artist. He's like three different bands and just amazing guy. And so I like, and when I met him, I really, the reason is like, I love all music. I could go on and on, but I really liked him as an artist. And then, you know, basically, you know, being backstage, just like, man, just like started talking and just like, man, you know, like I like just really hit it off with him.
That's so cool.
You know, like it's just, and there's very few artists that like, you know, that you do that with and, you know, and, but anyway, but yeah, that's the one guitar I have.
That's actually great. I love that. That's actually funny. Chad, I can't thank you enough for everything you've meant to me in my career, what you mean to Silicon Slopes, what you mean to this community. This community is so much better because of you. Thanks for coming on here and talking to us, and thanks for everything you do for us.
You're very welcome, man. I'd say I do it for the love of what you guys do, and I mean that. Like, there's just so many good companies that are involved and a way of giving back. So I appreciate everything you do for us.
I love it. Thanks, Chad.
You're welcome.